Heavenly Father, on this your special day, we, your family, come together to honor our Lord and Savior. Not because of what we have accomplished, but because our Heavenly Father has commanded. Lord, today we come together as a church seeking wisdom from on high. And what we pray for, Lord, is that you would be with us, that you would minister to us, and that you would bless us. This is our prayer. May God's children say, amen.
Remain standing for our opening hymn, number 213, Jesus is Coming Again. Do you believe that? Amen. Then sing like we believe it, number 213.
Please be seated for the tithes and offering.
The Illinois Actions for Worthy Students. Today's Illinois Action offering will provide much-needed financial aid to Illinois Conference. Worthy students attending our Adventist schools, as we do together. What no one church can do alone. Train up your child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Proverbs 22:6. The wisdom of Solomon reveals that one of the most important things we can give to our children is a Christian education. Consider the challenges they will face in this increasingly secular society, one in which God and his law have been removed not only from public school classrooms, but from the courtrooms and boardrooms of America. An Adventist Christian education will not only prepare our children for a life of service, It will equip them to recognize the deceptive teaching of these last days, such as evolutionary theories and situational ethics that could separate them from God. Your gift to the Illinois Conference Worthy Student Fund will help to provide an Adventist Christian education for our children, the future leaders of God's church. Please give generously. Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing all of us to be able to be here in your temple. Guide and watch over us throughout this day, and may the blessings come upon this offering for the students in our schools and elsewhere. We ask this blessing in your holy name. Amen.
You may be seated.
At this time, I'd like to invite everyone who could come to the front for our garden of prayer to lift up our prayers and supplications to the Lord. If you're not able to, you can stay where you are. You can be seated or you can be kneeling. Whatever it is, prepare our hearts for the Lord as we come to him, lifting our hearts and opening ourselves. Amen. Father God, as we prepare our hearts for your Holy Communion, we pray right now that we take this time, Lord, in a moment of silence, to ask you to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Father, as we contemplate on what we've done, Lord, and how we've hurt you, and how we've walked away from you, throughout the week, we pray that your Holy Spirit flood our hearts, Lord. Flood our hearts with your forgiveness and your holiness and your presence. Let's take this time to confess our sins to God, because he promised that he will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness and will cast it as far as the east is from the west. Lord, whatever we feel, we accept by faith your forgiveness, O God, that we come before you with a clean slate again, O Lord, white as snow, though our sins be as scarlet, O God. We thank you for the forgiveness of sins. We thank you, Lord, for your grace and mercy. And as we prepare our hearts, O God, we think of our friends who are not with you, who do not have you, Lord, who are hurting because of being away from you. We lift them up, O Lord. We ask for their salvation. We pray that you use us. You use, Lord, our ministry to reach out to the lost, God, our lost relatives, our lost neighbors, our lost co-workers, O God. We pray, Lord, that you give us the boldness to proclaim your word, O God, to them. Lord, come quickly, we pray, as we minister to those who are in a situation where they're hurting, in a situation where they're going through divorce or difficulties, oh God. Even we go through challenges because you said in your word, in the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world, Lord. So we speak from a position of victory, O God, because you are victorious, O God, the overcomer of Israel, the one who lifted us from the mires of sin, Lord, to the glorious light of your presence, O God. I pray right now for those who are sick, who have and still are going through struggles, Lord, health-wise, physically, emotionally, and mentally. I pray, Lord, that you bestow upon them a peace that passes all understanding, O God. I pray, Lord, that you make them feel and be aware of your presence in their lives, O God, that you would proclaim to them, Lord, that you will never leave them nor forsake them, because that's what you said in your word, Lord, that neither death nor principalities nor sickness can separate us from the love of God through Christ Jesus our Lord. I pray, O Father, Lord, for those who are struggling in faith, that you bestow upon them strength, O Lord. Renew their strength, O Father. I pray, Father, Lord, that your additional surge of faith, Lord, be upon them, that even as small as a mustard seed, O Lord, we can say to the mountain, move, and it will move, O Father, Lord. Give us that faith and strength, Lord, to move the mountains of despair, the mountains of depression, Lord, the mountains of sickness, the mountains of alienation, Lord, from one place to another, oh God, because you want us to be victorious, Lord. And help us, Lord, to overcome the enemy, Lord, because he is prowling around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. But greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world, oh God. So we come as conquering saints, oh Father, because you've already overcome the world. So we should be of good cheer, oh God. I lift a pastor to you, Lord. We look forward to receiving from you through him, through his sermon, oh Lord. I pray, Father, Lord, that your word will not return, and you said it in your word, will not return to you void, oh God. It will accomplish what it needs to accomplish in our hearts, in our lives, in our situations, oh God. Quicken our spirits, oh God, as your word is spoken. Touch his lips, his mind, and his heart, Lord, as he proclaim your word. And for those of us here, Lord, who really do not know you and have questions and struggles, oh Lord, please lift the cloud of doubt in our minds and in our hearts, Lord. But instead, speak of victory, oh Father. Speak of faith, Lord. Speak of things that can only be possible through you. Because you are God. All things are possible through God. And I thank you, oh Father, for the fellowship of believers, Lord. They will know we are Christians by our love for each other, oh God. And we pray, Lord, that you use this fellowship, Lord, to strengthen our faith. And let us be intentional in our prayers, oh Father, because, God, you love a willing heart, Lord. You said in your word, pray without ceasing. Give us that desire to pray without ceasing, oh God, to really be focused. Your son, Jesus Christ, oh Lord, is a great example of that. That while in the midst of agony, oh Father, before the cross, he prayed. He prayed earnestly to you. He sought your will. He sought your face. Give us that heart, Lord, the heart of Jesus Christ, who seeks your will and seeks your vision. You said in your word, without vision, people will perish, Lord. Give us that desire and vision, oh Lord, through prayers, through the power of your Holy Spirit. We ask you now, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stand for the reading of the scriptures. Today's reading is found in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 21. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each one of his sons of Joseph and worshiped, leaning on the top of his staff. This is the reading of the word of God. You may be seated.
Amen. Am I on? God is good? All the time? You know, it's been a month since I've seen you guys. Thank you. I've missed you guys too. Some of you have aged. What's going on? Or maybe I've aged. Well, my wife says that I actually look better now because I actually look more Hispanic because I got a little bit of a tan to me. You know, being in 102-degree weather for the last month does that to you, doesn't it? Man, it will burn you in no time. San Antonio is hot. Austin, Texas is hot. But when I got back, Chicago is cool. It's been great weather. You know, all those times that I've complained about the heat here in Chicago, I take it all back. Because when I got back, it was beautiful, great weather. Everything was green. We don't get a lot of green in San Antonio. But it's nice to be back with family. You know, I thought that one of the things I wanted to do when I got back is I wanted to share with you what took place at the General Conference session, because brothers and sisters, I said it before I left, I'll say it again. If you ever get the opportunity to go to a General Conference session, don't miss it. It is a once-in-a-lifetime experience. I'm going to explain that in a little bit. And the good news is that our next GC session will not take place in Texas. It will actually take place in our backyard. Because in 2020, if we're still here, it will take place in Indiana. And so I encourage you, if you can, make plans now. I remember that I actually had to book my hotel a year in advance because they told us that if you try 8 months in advance, you won't get a hotel room. Brothers and sisters, can you imagine having over 65,000 Adventists convening in one city and literally taking it over? It is experience like none other. It's an experience that you will never forget. I've been blessed to be able to see the last five GC sessions, and I've learned a lot. And I want to share with you just a little bit. Let me see if I turn this on here. Just a little bit of what I experienced so that you can taste a little bit what I experienced. The first thing that I did is, as many of you know, is I started out with the ministerial convention. And by the way, let me see, Daryl, if I can get this right. There we go. Ministerial convention, it was the first ever in our church, and it was called. And I have to say that it was something amazing to be able to see 5,000 pastors from all over the world coming together to learn how to be better pastors, to learn how to be able to be with other pastors, pray with other pastors, go to workshops with other pastors, eat with other pastors, and to be able to find out from leading authorities in our church how to do ministry better. And it was an exciting thing. There you can see, place is packed out. This is one of the speakers. His name happens to be Henry Wright, one of my favorite speakers of all time, because he's a man who's been a pastor for many, many, many years. And I was very blessed by his sermon that day. As you can see there, this is Riverwalk of San Antonio. If you've ever been to San Antonio, you know that one of the things that is interesting about San Antonio is that it has a riverwalk, and it is beautiful. On a hot summer day, it's kind of nice to go down there and actually be able to just do a tour of the city right from the riverwalk. I want to take you to, that's the logo for San Antonio. This was the hottest topic. In fact, it's interesting, throughout the whole GC session, the delegates would come in and out and trickle in and out, but the day that we voted on women's ordination, I don't think anyone left the entire day. It was packed, and everybody wanted to know what was going to happen. I thought I'd share it with you. I found it interesting that 977 people voted yes, 1,381 voted no, and 5 abstained. Our church is still growing, isn't it? We have not fallen. One of the things that I always say is that we always worry too much about some of these things, and I truly believe this is God's church. And because it's his church, at the end of the day, all we need to do is move forward in confidence. If we've prayed about it, then we have to just have faith that God is going to move among his people. And he did. And what I would like to say is I don't say that because the outcome was no woman's ordination. This is not about pro or against. It's about at the end of the day, we all experienced unity. And what's interesting, look at those numbers. There's basically about less than little over 400 vote difference between pro or against. So what that tells me is that the church is pretty almost 50-50 either way. But what was incredible was not that. It was that once the vote was cast, everyone basically went back to being a united church. And I love that. What makes us is not what we believe, but in whom we believe. Can I get another amen to that? What makes us is not what we believe, it's who we believe. Jesus, the Bible tells us, is the author and the finisher. He is the CEO of this church. And I'm so glad that we have a church that still believes in the power of prayer. Let me show you something else. This is one of the many halls there where we had exhibits that took place. Anyone who was part of the Adventist church pretty much had an exhibit there, and it was pretty interesting that I've never seen anything like it. They had climbing walls in there. They had dinosaurs in there. I should have taken this picture and put it in here as well. They actually had a replica of the very Bible that Ellen G. White held in her hand for people to take pictures with. I don't want to say that this was an amusement park, but it looked a lot like an amusement park. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying to shoot down the church and the booths, because I think it was very important. There was a lot of good material that was given there. And I'm also glad that we had things like climbing walls, because you know what? A lot of our young people were actually in this area because there was something for them. And so what was really nice about this convention center and the way they did it is that there was something for every person of every age. That's the way the church should be. Amen? It's not just about the adults. It's about everyone feeling like there is something for them. And that was a beautiful aspect of the convention center. Let's go to the next slide here. This is Sabbath worship. This is the Alamo Dome where the San Antonio Spurs play. It was amazing to see over 65,000 people sitting there singing, "Jesus is coming again." Now, I wanted to actually show that video, but I said, you know what, I better not. I don't want you guys to basically, it's long. But if you ever do get a moment, go to Facebook and look up the GC session, and you'll be able to see that video. It was unbelievable. One of those highlights of my life when we can literally sit there and I look back and I sit there and I say, this is amazing. And it doesn't even pale in comparison to what will happen when we get to heaven. It's quite a spectacle to see. This is the announcement of Ted Wilson as being our president again. Can we get an amen? I believe he's done a very good job. I think he's a very God-centered man. And I appreciate that we reelected him again, because I think one of the things that he's made very, very, very central to our church is the importance of evangelism. And so I love that about him. It was an incredible scene. Now, I want to share with you some statistics, and this is the heart of what I wanted to share with you today. In 2014, we had the highest number of baptisms. We had the highest number of churches planted. We had the 10th consecutive year of more than 1 million baptisms. Can I get an amen? We had the 12th consecutive year of more than 2,000 new churches that were actually established. Amen? Our church is growing. Let me share with you the SDA World Presence. Here you see the breakdown of countries recognized by the United Nations. Of the 237 countries in the world today, and how many countries is our church? 215. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we are fulfilling the great commission to go to all the world, right? And here we have proof of it. 215 of the 237. It was really beautiful to see. I want to explain this for a moment here. This is basically the global north and south window, and I'm explaining to you in a moment. But you can see there and see where that big wavy line is. No, that's not some kind of prehistoric dinosaur. That is actually the line that is drawing that differentiates the south from north in our church. This is not world recognized. This is SDA recognized. Now, keep that in mind, because what you'll see there is that pretty much everything south of the United States is considered to be south. Okay? Why is that important? Because look at this. In 1960, the north-south ratio, 54% of Adventists were from the south, as opposed to 46% that were from the north. Look at 2014. We've gone from basically being a 54% in the South to now being how much of our church? 92% of our church is found south of the border. Is that staggering or what? Brothers and sisters, that's why I am saying to you, the missionary field is no longer the third world. The missionary field is United States of America, Europe. That was staggering to me. I appreciate that they shared this with us. Look at this. In terms of baptisms, in 1960, 69% of the baptisms were from the South and 31% were from the North. Look at 2014. 97% of our baptisms as a worldwide church come from the South. And only 3% come from the North. It's amazing how things have just completely changed. Here's another interesting one. Number of SDA churches worldwide. In 1960, 44% of churches were in south of the border and 54% were north, here in the United States and so forth. Look at what happened in 2014. I can't even make out this picture, sorry. I took this picture from way back in the stadium. 12% of our churches that have been established are here in the United States. And we're looking at what? I think that's 82%, or is it 68%? I can't make out that number, guys. I'm sorry. 88. Thank you very much. Big difference. Big difference. Here's another one. The breakdown of world membership by continent and region. This is interesting. In 1960, Latin America was only 10%. North America was 37%. Europe was 16%. Asia, 14%. Africa, 19%. Oceania is 4%. Look at 2014. Latin America and Africa represent 37 and 38%. North America, in terms of its growth, has only experienced a 7% growth. That is startling. Now let me share with you how this breaks down. What that means is that in 1960, out of 100 people, 27 were Adventists in North America. It's pretty good at 27%. You get what that means? That means that out of, let's say, 10 people, 33 of them were Adventist. Latin America, it was 20. Africa, 19. Europe, 16. Asia, 14. Oceania, 4. Look at what happens next. As of 2014, of 100 people, 38 people in Africa are Seventh-day Adventist. 32 in Latin America. Asia, 19. How many in North America? We've gone from being 27 to being now only 7 out of 100 people. Europe is even worse off. 2, that is important because where did the Reformation begin? In Europe. The very place that was the seed of Reformation, what brought us what we have here today, is now where there is the least amount of Seventh-day Adventists and Christians. In 2010 to 2014, 6,212,919 people were added to the church. Can we get an amen? That's staggering. Look at this. That's even more staggering. So what we're basically saying is that over 6 million people came into our church in those 4 years, and how many of them left? More than half. Brothers and sisters, this is a problem that our church needs to fix. And notice that I say church, I didn't say leadership of the church. We need to fix. What good does it do that we bring them in, but we can't keep them in? We've got to work on that. I have to work on it. You have to work on it. We have got to change this. This is staggering, but I appreciate that our church brought this to our attention. Because I think this speaks volumes of our church. You see, the GC session isn't about just going all coming together, 65,000 people and patting each other on the back. It's about recognizing that we have much to accomplish. and we need to get there, and by God's grace, we will. But we have some work to do. This is interesting. Between 2000 and 2014, we have literally lost 48% of our members, which means out of half of the people that come through these doors and get baptized, half of them will basically leave. What's staggering to me is that in the last 4 years, that has gone from 48% to now being 60%. People, we're going in the wrong direction. We've got to focus more on retention now. Staggering. I want to end with this quote. I love this quote that was shared. Ellen White wrote, "God expects personal service from the pastor, from the first elder, from the elders, from the church leaders, from the Bible worker." It says, "From everyone to whom he has entrusted a knowledge of the truth for this time." Not all can go as missionaries to foreign lands, but all can be home missionaries in their families and neighborhoods. Brothers and sisters, I'm just letting you know, at our next church board meeting, I've already told Brother Arnie, we're going to change the way that we do church board meetings. Ellen G. White says the best way to stop people from basically being distracted is to distract them in evangelism. And so what I'm going to be doing is taking to our board, and I'm letting our board know this in advance. We're going to change the structure of the way we do boards. And now what we're going to do is we're going to basically put evangelism on the higher level as opposed to not on there at all. Brothers and sisters, we talk all the time that the world is coming to an end, but we don't act like it's coming to an end. And so one of the things that I feel convicted that I need to do, and hopefully you'll join me in that, is to try to make evangelism be a more pivotal part, an integral part of what we do as a church. Now, that does not mean that we're not doing a lot, brothers and sisters. It means that we're not doing enough. We can do more. And that's what we need to do, is to do better. Because I believe God expects better. And so I'm committed to that. I know that our board will be as well. But I'm sharing with you that that is something that we're going to be working on for the next year. Now, I want to start, let me back this up, because I want to start by doing the following. You know, as I thought about what I can share as a sermonette this morning, I did a lot of soul searching and praying, because, brothers and sisters, I've been gone from this pulpit for the last month. And this week, as I was preparing for prayer meeting, God led me to what I needed to share with our church. First, he told me to share it with the prayer meeting people, but then he convicted me that I needed to share that message with you as well. So I'm going to encourage you to take a moment right now with me and pray. So I have something important to share. Join me. Kind and gracious Heavenly Father, once again, I find myself in an unworthy position. Like that flawed prophet Jonah, I am not worthy to be your mouthpiece. Lord, today I pray that as we prepare our hearts for the Lord's Supper, that Lord, you would just share with us just for a few moments a glimpse of your character, that we may be inspired and participate your communion. Lord, open our eyes and our ears that we may be receptive to your word. This is our prayer. May God's children say, Amen. As I was thinking about what to share, I shared with you that God convicted me to share what I shared at prayer meeting, because I think it's something that is very applicable. Now, many of you know that in prayer meeting, we've been studying the book of Genesis, and I find it interesting that when I came to this church, one of the things that I instituted right away is I said, I want to change the way we do prayer meeting. I remember sitting down with Arnie, our first elder, and saying, look, Arnie, I know that what we've been doing is good, but I believe that we first need to be a people of the Bible. Nothing against the spirit of Ellen G. White, which we call the spirit of prophecy. That's a good thing. And I rely on her writing. But one of the things that I've always said, and Ellen G. White said her best, we are to first look to God's word. And then spirit of prophecy is there to complement his word. And so I said, we need to go back to the basics. So here's what we're going to do for a prayer meeting. We're going to basically do away with Ellen G. White. No offense, Ellen G. White. But we're going to go back to the Bible. And we're going to go through it chapter by chapter, verse by verse. And so we started with the book of Genesis. And I found it interesting that as soon as I got back, we found ourselves in the last chapter of Genesis. Now, brothers and sisters, you know, this is interesting. Because I've been the pastor of this church in November. It will be 2 years. Thank you. All right, I got some work to do with the rest of you. It will be 2 years. And what it means is that it's taken us 2 years to be able to just get through the book of Genesis. Now, what that tells me is that we have not rushed through it. We have savored it. I've learned a lot. Genesis is one of my favorite books of the Bible. And every time I open it up, I find things that I never had seen before. And I want to encourage you to come out to prayer meeting. I'm giving you a glimpse of what takes place in prayer meeting. What I want to do is I want to share with you and give you a context. For those of you that have not been coming to prayer meeting, you're not going to know where we're at in the story. So I'm going to basically give you a recap of where we are and where we left off in the book of Genesis. Here's the recap. From the moment that Jacob deceived his father, Jacob had sinned and had deeply suffered. Many years of toil, care, and sorrow had been his since the day when his great sin caused him to flee from his father's tents. A homeless fugitive separated from his mother, whom he never saw again. Laboring 7 years for whom he loved, only to be basely cheated. Toiling 20 years in the service of a covetous and grasping kinsman. Seeing his wealth increasing and sons rising around him, but finding little joy in the contentious and divided household. Distressed by his daughter's shame, by her brother's revenge, by the death of Rachel, by the unnatural crime of Reuben, by Judah's sin, by the cruel deception and malice practiced toward Joseph. How long and dark is the catalog of evils spread out to view. Again and again, he had reaped the fruit of that first wrong deed. Over and over, he saw repeated among his sons the sins of which he himself had been guilty. But bitter as had been the discipline, it had accomplished its work. As Hebrews 12:11 says, the chastening, though grievous, had yielded the peaceable fruit of righteousness. You know, Jacob fascinates me. Because the more and more I study his life, the more and more I see a reflection of my life. Today I want to spend a few moments studying the last moments of his life. We're going to look at Genesis chapter 49, verse 32, because there we find the last moments of Jacob recorded. I have it up here on the screen for you. I want to share with you what he says, because there's some powerful words here for us today. Listen to what it says. It says, then he charged them and said to them, I am to be gathered to my people. Bury with me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Ephron the Hittite. 30. In the cave that is in the field of Machpelah, which is before Mamre, in the land of Canaan, which Abraham bought with the field of Ephron the Hittite as a possession for a burial place. There, it says in 31, they buried Abraham and Sarah, his wife. There, the Bible goes on to say, they buried Isaac and Rebekah, his wife. And there they buried who? Leah. Now what's interesting to me is, I asked this question at prayer meeting, is what was Jacob manifesting when he asked to be gathered unto his people? You see, brothers and sisters, whenever we study the Bible, we need to make sure that we don't just listen. We need to make sure that we ask. Because I would like to say that when we ask questions of God, God is always faithful in answering. But a lot of times I believe that we fall short in our spiritual walk with God, in our daily walk with God, because we just want to get through the material instead of being one with the material. And when we ask questions, what we're saying, God, we really want to know. We want to understand. And so questions have a great way of being able to help us understand who God is. Now, I'm going to answer the question not from my own words, because who am I? I'm going to choose the mouthpiece of God, Ellen G. White. Patriarchs and Prophets, look at what it says. The last blessings pronounced, Jacob repeated the charge concerning his burial place. Quote, I am to be gathered unto my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Machpelah. There they buried Abraham and Sarah his wife. There they buried Isaac and Rebekah his wife. And there I buried Leah. And this is what grabs me about what Ellen G. White says. Thus, the last act of his life was to do what? Manifest his faith in God's promise. Do you catch the irony of this statement, brothers and sisters? I do. Jacob's whole life was epitomized by his lack of faith in God's promise. Isn't that what got him into trouble in the first place? Instead of waiting upon God when God had promised him that he would be the inheritor, he listened to his mother and he jumped the gun. He got ahead of God. And so isn't it interesting that it took him an entire lifespan to get to the final point where he realized, I need to trust and have faith in God's promise. You know, this is one of the reasons why I say that I have a lot in common with Jacob. Because there are promises that still today I know, but I wouldn't be so bold as to say that I claim them. Yet here Jacob finds himself recognizing at the end of the day that God is faithful to his promises. Now you have to understand the depth of this. Remember, Jacob, when he went and deceived his father, what was he deceiving him for? And what is the blessing? Let me suggest to you that it is God's promise. Isn't that interesting? Wow. See, before dying, what Jacob did is he made manifest. He made clear. Jacob's last act was to make clear his faith in God's promises. Now look at what the next few verses have to say. 49:32. Look at what it says here. The field and the cave that is there were purchased from the sons of who? Heth. Thank you very much. And when Jacob had finished commanding his sons, what did it say he did? He drew his what? I love that. He drew his feet up into the bed and breathed his last breath and was then gathered to his people. Now, we know that gathered to his people means what? He passed away. Remember in the verse earlier, he talks about he wants to go be put where? His father, his mother, his grandfather, his grandmother, where his wife lay. He wanted to be gathered with his people. As Jacob was passing away, what do you think the sense and the tone of Jacob's life was? You know, as I was reading this, I couldn't help but ask that question. Look at it again. You know, you have to appreciate where I came from to be able to understand why this is makes sense to me. I just came back from being in Texas. And while I was there in Texas, one of the things that struck me when you're driving through the country of, and I say it's a country because Texas is huge. As I was driving through that country, you find a lot of bumper stickers on vehicles. And there was one place in Texas where I remember being parked behind a car that basically said this. And it was referring to a person when they pass away. Don't let me die with my boots off. Now, the reason why that person says it is because they are a cowboy, true and true. In fact, we know cowboys by their boots. And as I was reading this text, you know, that vision, that the imagery came to mind, because what did Jacob do? It says that after finishing his command to his sons, he did what? He drew up his feet into the bed and breathed his last breath. Wow. You see, to me, what this shows me is a man who is at peace with God. I don't know what's going to happen if you're able to be in a situation where you are literally confronting death. But you know, if you turn on the radio or the television, death is all around us now, brothers and sisters. And what's interesting is a lot of the death that we're seeing is from people who are doing normal, common, ordinary things, like going to a movie theater, like going to a church. Let me suggest to you that when that moment arrives, whether you are in the comfort of a church or in a mall, how will you respond? You see, the one word that I would use to describe Jacob's death is the word peaceful. Now, Ellen G. White tends to agree with me. Let me take you again to Patriarchs and Prophets. Look what it says. Jacob's last years brought an evening of what? Tranquility and repose after a troubled and weary day. Clouds had gathered dark above his path, yet his sun set clear, and the radiance of heaven illumined his parting hours. Says the scripture, I love this, it's Zechariah 14:7, at evening time it shall be light. Powerful. You know, this raises a question that must be asked. We live in a world that is void of peace, amen? We live in a world that is contentious, controversial, rude, unapologetic. We live in a world where life really doesn't matter. That's why a person can go in the middle of a church, be there, give their lives to God, and then in that same breath, literally shoot people. In a world that is void of peace, how is it possible that this man, Jacob, had peace? That's strange to me, because I read to you the recap of his life. Does that sound to you like a guy who had filled life with peace? I believe that here in the death of Jacob, we find evidence of a promise from God. I want to share it with you because I found this nugget this week, and I've just been tickled pink ever since. I want you to turn your Bibles with me to Psalm 37:37. Look at what it says here. What does it say? Mark the what? The perfect man. And behold what? The upright. For the end of that man is what? Is peace. You see, the Bible says that those who are upright, who are perfect, will die peacefully. Brothers and sisters, would you like to die a peaceful death? I know I do. You have the key now. Is God faithful to his promises? Amen. So you can take that to the bank. Now, this is very important because when I was in San Antonio, the day in which we concluded the meetings, it was a highlight of my life, one of the many. I consider marrying my wife to probably be one of the greatest highlights of my life. The day that I gave my life to Christ was another great highlight of my life. The day that my kids were born was another great highlight of my life. When I became the pastor of this church, it was a highlight of my life. Do you know why I say that? I'm not saying that to basically just throw compliments on you. There is no greater feeling than knowing that you are fulfilling the will of God. And for everyone who is here and involved in the election of me becoming the pastor of this church, every one of them will tell you that it was very clear that God had called me to be the pastor of this church. Now, that is not a reflection of how good I am, because I'm not. In fact, I'm not a very good pastor. This is just a reflection of who God is and what his will is. And I got to tell you, if you've ever been in that place where you know without a shadow of a doubt that you are in God's will, that is an awesome place to be. It's so awesome that when you find yourself out of it, you are afflicted because you want to get back there. When I came back, as I was coming back, I came back because my wife and I made a decision that we needed to cancel our vacation and head back home. You see, we had received a phone call on the night that we were having the end, last meeting of the General Conference session, and it was some sad news. A man by the name of Dr. Campos Swiscoon had called me to let me know that he wasn't doing so good. I remember not long after that, his brother called me and said, "Pastor, I just want to let you know your first elder probably won't make it through the night." I remember turning to my wife and asking her, "Honey, what do we do?" I love that about my wife. She places God before our family. She says, "We need to go back. Vacations can wait." So we decided to cancel our vacation. And we made it back here. I didn't make it in time. He passed away while I was on the way. But I remember as I was driving back, countless times my wife and I would talk about the impact that this would have on the church. You see, you have to understand, I've been blessed, and I said this to Arnie the other day, and as usual in humility, he said, "Praise be to God." I've always been blessed with great elders. Dr. Swiscoon was a great elder. One of the few people I know that gave 2/3 of his salary to the church. No, I'm not talking about a tenth, as some of us do. I'm not talking about 15, which some of us few do. I'm talking about 2/3 of his salary was given to the church. And what was amazing about this doctor, he didn't just give to the church. He gave to the kids of the church. Anyone who's on our school board knows Dr. Swiscoon because they know that this man believed in Adventist education so much that what he did is he literally would give $2,000 every month so that the kids from the Lighthouse Spanish Church could come to our Adventist Christian school. You know, he could have taken that money and bought himself a lot of homes, a lot of fancy vacations, nice cars. He could even fixed up his home. Yet he understood what was really important. And so he gave the majority of his money away because he understood that what matters in life is not the money, but the lives that matter.
came home. And I had the privilege to be able to actually preside over his funeral. You know, brothers and sisters, you can tell about a person, a lot about a person when they die. Most of us, when we die, the day that we have our funeral, and obviously we won't be able to witness it ourselves, we'll know that it will basically be there, and the majority of people who will be there will be our family, and then it'll be our church members. What was fascinating about Dr. Siskun is that when he died, and we had our funeral, the church that has only capacity for about 150 people, 160 at most, we had over 380 people there that day. Over 65% of the people that were there were not even Adventists. You see, this was a man who basically was not just a good Christian Adventist in church. He was a good Christian Adventist wherever he went. I remember that much of the last week, this last week that we just had and the week before, I spent it on the phone numerous times with people who don't even attend the church calling me, asking me information about this doctor. I remember going on the radio because one local radio DJ literally had a friendship with him. He says, I want to dedicate an entire hour of radio programming just to the life of this doctor because he was such an important part of our community. And so I got the privilege to be on radio and be interviewed about this man, and I was able to actually have the privilege of bringing his brothers and sisters to the interview on radio. And as people called in, what was amazing to me is that they would all talk about this man who was so Christ-like. What captures me about what I'm sharing with you right now is this. Over the last 3 or 4 months, this is a man who was known for basically running marathons. He'd run all the major marathons, competed in them. Average is basically running 25 miles every other day. Been a vegan his entire life. Led a perfect life in the sense of health-wise. Vegan, doesn't eat meat, exercises regularly, rests regularly. He's a doctor. He knows how his body works. And yet mysteriously one day wakes up 61 years of age and finds out that he's got a tumor the size of a baseball in his stomach. And what fascinates me is how he responded to that. You see, many of us in that situation, we would say, God, you have done me wrong. I've been faithful to you. I've been the best vegan. I ran marathons. I gave lots of money for you. He could have easily just turned the corner and said, how dare you treat me this way? I don't deserve this. What was amazing to me is that this man, who weighed about 185 pounds, had dwindled down to 120 pounds in a matter of 3 months. And I remember that we had a vigil. Twice we had vigils at the church for him. I remember him standing up at one vigil in front of the entire church, this shell of a man who had lost so much weight, and he's looking at all these people who were there praying for him the entire night. And what was amazing to me is he sat there and he looked at him and he says, do not cry for me. I am at peace with God. See, that's why when I went through the last couple of weeks, I couldn't help but think of Jacob's life as I read this chapter and I studied it. Because, brothers and sisters, this was a man that was at peace. And what was the key to being at peace in the moment of his death? Psalm 37:37 said that he was a righteous man. I have one more thing that I want to share with you. I want you to go to Genesis chapter 50, verse 1. I have it up here on the screen for you because here is something that captivated my attention again. Listen to what it says. Then Joseph fell on his father's face and wept over him. and kissed him. Now you're going to say, Pastor, that's nice, but I don't see it. Seems like just a typical thing that a person would do. Oh, contrary. Because you see, let me suggest to you that in this verse, a prophecy is being fulfilled. Do you know what prophecy that is? Let me take you to it. See if I can find it. Genesis chapter 46, verse 4 says the following. I will go down with thee into Egypt. This is God talking to Jacob. And I will also surely bring thee up again. And what does it say? And Joseph shall put his hands upon thine eyes. Do you understand the depth, the meaning of that prophecy? You see, here's the beauty of God. God had told Jacob that the day would come where when he was ready to pass away, that God would give him the privilege of the last thing that he sees on earth be the son who he had lost. Do you understand the awesomeness of that verse? Do you know how much that tells you about God? That he literally created a prophecy just to bring joy to Jacob. You guys know the story. I don't have to contextualize it, do I? Jacob loved Joseph so much that when Jacob disappeared, Jacob's relationship with God disappeared. And it took many years before Jacob came to terms with God. And the Bible says that when Joseph came back into his life, the Bible says that Jacob's soul was revived. In other words, Jacob experienced revival and reformation. Brothers and sisters, God didn't hold against Jacob what he had done. He loved Jacob so much that he promised him that the thing that he loved most would be the very last thing that he would see when he would pass away. The beauty of that is simple, guys. We have a God that is so awesome that he even thinks about the small things that bring us joy. I love that about him. That same God that today we are invited to come and to honor him and his last moments. Because let me suggest to you that when Jesus died, what was the last thing that he saw? The people he wanted to save. You. That was what he wanted to see last. He didn't want to see God. Oh, he loved God. But he wanted to see the very people that he loved so much that he gave his life for. Now, that is the kind of Jesus, the kind of God that I want to be a part of. Brothers and sisters, today we get the honor and privilege to be able to take part in something so sacred, something so romantic, as to remember the one who gave his life for us. Jesus Christ today invites you and me, stay. Break bread with me. Will you do that today? If you're willing to stay today, please take a stand. It's okay. Stand. Those of you who are willing today to stay for communion, please stand. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we often say that the devil is in the details. But today, God, you have revealed that that is not true. Today, you have shown us that you are God of the details. Because you take the smallest details of our lives and you pay attention. Lord, today is no small detail. But we pray, Lord, that today as we stay here and we honor the one who gave his life for us, that, Lord, you will see that we too want to share with you in this precious act. Lord, help us to be deliberate. Help us to be intentional about what we do and say right now, that we may not only hear what you have done, but that we may see, taste, and experience the sacrifice made for us. Lord, thank you for this sacrifice. In your precious name we ask. Let all God's people say, amen.
Please be seated as Brandy and Gabriel come up.
Jesus, I have decided to give this to you.
Really? You know whoever sits here makes all the decisions, right?
I know. And Jesus, all your decisions are perfect. So giving that to you is my last decision.
Okay. I'm honored. This is great.
Yeah, you like it? How's
this
it feel?
Good.
Yeah?
This is good.
Good. Oh, hi.
Credit card came in.
Oh, no
way.
It's
time to go shopping.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, wait. I thought you and your husband were trying to get out of debt.
Yeah, I know. Money's tight. But I had my eye on these new Jimmy Choo shoes and the Christian Dior bag.
Yeah.
My husband doesn't have to know.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Do you want to go?
No.
No?
No?
I don't know. I need to think about it. Let me get back to you, okay?
All right. No problem. Just give me a call.
Okay, will do.
What's going on here?
What do you mean?
I'm kind of one-cheeking it here. You do want me to sit here, right?
Oh, yes, of course. Sit there. I'm so sorry. I'm sorry.
As long as you're sure.
I'm positive. Go ahead. That's yours.
Let's try this again.
Okay.
Your phone's ringing.
Oh, thanks.
Who is it?
It's Stephanie. I already know what she wants. She wants me to volunteer.
Oh, you should answer the phone then.
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I can never tell her no.
Well, you should answer the phone then.
Oh, look at that. I missed the call.
So this whole stool thing.
Yeah?
Who's making the decisions?
You are.
Why are you sitting on it?
Oh, my bad. I'm so sorry. I was just, I was caught up in not answering the phone. Here, this really is yours. Please, have a seat.
Positive.
Absolutely. Okay. It's yours.
Let's try this again.
Okay, I'm so sorry.
I've noticed you're losing your temper a lot lately.
Oh, Jesus, you don't know the whole situation.
I don't.
No, there's a lot going on.
I'm just saying, your attitude is a decision.
Yeah, and You just don't understand the whole situation, you know.
I know you're under a lot of pressure.
Pressure, Jesus, you don't understand pressure.
Okay. Yeah, this isn't working.
What do you mean? I don't understand.
We can't both be on the stool. It's either me or it's you.
I know, Jesus, it's just, I didn't realize this was going to be so difficult. I'm sorry. Here, just take it.
I can't just take it. You have to choose to give it to me.
Here, just take it out of my hands.
Make the choice.
I can't.
You just did.
I want to encourage you, please stay, take part of this most special act that we will celebrate today. I want to encourage you, please stay. You will be blessed. God bless you. Have a happy Sabbath. We'll see you soon.
Respective locations, the families and the couples will go to the cafeteria. Of course, for the children, please stay here, Miss Wanda. Frank will do the children's story, sit up front. And for the women, it'll be in the preschool. And for the men, it'll be behind the curtains here. So I invite you to go ahead and go to those respective areas depending on where you need to go. Thank you so much. And then we'll meet here later on for the service.
Would the children like to come up here for their story? Hi. Happy Sabbath. Hi. Go ahead and find a seat. You want to sit up here with me? You want to go sit with Daryl? Oh, you want to talk. Oh, he wants to pray for us. Thank you. He opened our story with a prayer. How precious. You want to open our story with a prayer? Let her. It's her turn.
Jesus, he made a yay.
Oh, wow.
That's really good. Really good.
Thank you. Well, I want to tell you a story. How about if you say the prayer after the story for me? Okay? Okay. I want to tell you a story of a lady. Her name is Rhoda. She was with all of Jesus' followers, this is after Jesus, and they were praying for Peter because he was in jail. And they were afraid that the people that jailed him were going to kill him. So they prayed and they prayed and they prayed. And there was a... somebody's at the door. There you go. She went to the door and opened it. There was Peter. And she was so excited because how did he get out of jail? So she got so excited. Let's run. She got so excited. Peter's here. Peter's here. Peter's here. And you know what? They looked at her like she was crazy. What do you mean Peter's here? He's in jail. You know what she forgot to do? At the door, she left Peter there. She didn't even invite him in. She wouldn't have had to tell her, but she was so excited because she loved Peter so much. Well, we all have a door. And we do the same thing sometimes. Jesus is at our door. Do you guys know where your door is? Do you guys, anybody knows where that door is? Is it in here? Well, here. Yeah, Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and sup with him." But you know what happens sometimes? Sometimes when we first meet Jesus, when we first hear that, we get so excited and we run. Jesus is here. I have met Jesus, and he's so full of love. I love Jesus. Jesus is here. Jesus is here. But where is Jesus? He's still standing at the door. We can't leave him at the door. He wants to come in and sup with us and eat with us and be with us and live with us. But he can't do that from the door. Every day, just like, do we eat every day? Okay, let me have that back now. Go sit down. You'll be next, okay? So, what do we have to do every single day? Do we have to listen for the knock? Do we have to remember to let Jesus in? And after we let Jesus in, guess what? When we go to you and to you and to you and say, Jesus is here, we're taking Jesus with us. And people can see him, and they won't think we're crazy. They'll go, wow, there's something special here. Can we remember? I do. You know what? I wake up almost every day at 4 in the morning, and I don't know why, but I wake up every day at 4 in the morning. I think that's when Jesus knocks at my heart, because then I get up, and I get on my knees, and I say a prayer for Jesus to be in my day, in my heart, all day. Jesus likes to have a special time with us. And if you listen to that knock at the door, you'll know when Jesus is here. Amen? Would you like to say our prayer for us? You want to knock at the door too, huh? There you go. You want to say a prayer with Jesus? No? Do you want to say the prayer?
Tell Jesus, thank you for your highness, taking my mom, and she prayed with Jesus.
Amen. Would you all like to go back to your seats now? And remember, yeah, you like that, huh?
Thank you.
How many times? For some of us, it may be the first time. For many of us, it will be not the first, not the second, but we have participated in this act numerous times. Why? Is it because we're short of memory? Is it because we suffer from amnesia? Do we have Alzheimer's? Do we suffer from dementia? The reason why we do this is because God commanded it so. Because he looks for an opportunity for us to engage with him. That engaging is not just about what we do in our offerings. It's not just about what we do with our time. It's not just about what we do with our profession, our home. It's about reminiscing about the past. And one of the things that my wife and I love to do when we sit down, it's not so much to go and do something that we've never done before. Sometimes the greatest joy comes from just sitting there and remembering things from the past. What we are about to do is a solemn act, but it is not to be mistaken with a sad act. It is a celebration. And so today, we want to invite you. Join us as a word of prayer as we begin the celebration. Let's pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is this heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Heavenly Father, this institution that you have created called the communion, we take part in this act because we do not want to forget. Lord, be with us as we take a moment to reminisce with our Savior. In your precious name we ask. Amen. Brothers and sisters, you will notice that I have a handkerchief in my hand. This is something I like to say is old school. Most men nowadays don't wear handkerchiefs. I remember growing up, my dad told me you must always wear a handkerchief with your suit.
And I never understood why until one day I caught out of the corner of my eye my father handing that handkerchief to my mother. She'd been touched by a sermon, and she was shedding a tear. Came to understand the importance of a handkerchief. Oh, it may not be part of our culture today, but I would like to suggest that we have made it a part of our culture of the Lord's Supper. Because you see, this handkerchief is symbolic. When I wipe my hands with it, what we are saying is that we corporately have finished the act of humility. We have washed away the sins of our lives through the washing of our feet. We have humbled ourselves before our Savior by the washing of each other's feet and the confession of our sins. Today, once again, by putting down this napkin, we declare we are prepared to receive the bread and the wine. At this moment, at our church, we have a beautiful custom. We believe that it's important for our young people to also not only understand what we are doing, but to participate as well. And so I'm going to ask our first elder to please extend this to our two ladies who will come forward. And then we're going to invite the young people, the little kids. This is your opportunity to participate with us, the adults. And so we want to invite you to please come forward and pick up a grape and wait for us if you can. I know it's hard, but if you can, wait for us until we tell you, and then you'll be able to eat the grape at the same time that we eat the bread and drink the wine. Thank you. And now we're going to ask our first elder to lead us in a scripture followed by prayer. Then it will be followed by our second elder with another scripture followed by a prayer.
The reading is in Matthew chapter 26, verses 17 to 21. Now on the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying to him, "Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?" And he said, "Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.'" So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. When evening had come, he sat down with the 12. Now, as they were eating, he said, "Assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me." At this time, I'd like to invite everyone, if you could, to kneel as I pray. Father God, it is a humbling experience to be before you, Lord, as we celebrate this Holy Communion. I pray, O Father, that as we partake of the bread, let us be reminded of what you've done on the cross for us, Lord. Your body hanging on the cross reminded us that you've taken all the sins of the world so that we would have eternal life. We pray, O Father, that you prepare our hearts as we receive you in ours. And I pray, O Father God, that if there's any iniquity that's hindering us from receiving you, we ask, O Father, that you forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thank you for your Holy Spirit being part of our Holy Communion. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Verse 22 reads like this. And they were exceeding sorrowful, and began every one of them to say unto him, Lord, is it I? And he answered and said, he that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. The Son of Man, God, as it is written of him. But woe unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had not been born. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Father of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Heavenly Father, you that know everything from the beginning to the end. You, Father God, that knows every one of our actions, good or bad. You, Father, that took the time to plan our creation, to create us, to give us a Savior, your Son, Jesus Christ, that one day came down and walked the streets and valleys and roads of the Holy Land, where he preached and thought and lived among all the sick, the sad and the happy, the one man that died for you and me. I pray, Lord, that this wonderful service, in the moment where we take this wine that will represent your blood, amen, will be of great importance in our lives. Lord, I pray that you will bless every one of us. And when we leave this place, we can truly say and recognize that we were in your presence.
Amen.
Lord, I know you suffered quite a bit. And you continue to suffer because you want every one of us to be safe. Amen. To take your blood and accept that wonderful sacrifice. Lord, in that blood that you spread for our salvation, I lay my prayers and I ask to forgive us in the wonderful, wonderful name of Jesus. Amen.
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 As many of you know, whenever we have communion, one of the things that we do is that we make sure that the bread on top is not broken. Now, the reason why we do that is because this serves as a symbol. The Bible tells us that this bread is the body of Christ. When Jesus Christ died for you and I, his body was broken. When we break this bread, what we in essence are saying is that we remember and we recognize that his body was broken for you and for me. We do not do it because we find joy in breaking our Savior's body. We do so because we recognize that it's important to remember the pain in order to appreciate the privilege. It's when we remember the pain that we appreciate the privilege. The greatest joys that we have in our life many times are our children. And I find it interesting that they can be the very thing that hurts us the most. But they are our greatest privilege. And the pain does not wither our love for them. It helps us to appreciate the privilege of being their parent. At this moment, I want to invite the elders and the deacons to please stand as we get ready to pass out the bread and the wine. You know, something that you will notice is that our deacons and deaconesses have gloves on. Is that because they're afraid of being infected? Is the bread or the wine contaminated? No. One of the things that the Bible teaches us clearly is that the definition of holy in the Old Testament is to be set apart. When we put on the gloves, what we are basically saying is that we are setting apart this bread, this grape juice, for a specific and holy purpose. I'm going to invite our elders now to pick up the plates. I want to read to you, continuing from Matthew 26, verses 25 to 28. We left off with Judas betraying. Then Judas, which had been betrayed him, answered and said, "Master, is it I?" He said unto him, "Thou hast said." As they were eating, Jesus took the bread and blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took the cup, and gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it, for this is my body of the New Testament, which is shed for the many for the remission of sins." The time has arrived. I want to ask you, please, as you take of the bread and you drink of the grape juice, take a moment for silent contemplation. Reminisce about your relationship with Jesus Christ. Know not about what you have not done, but about who he is, what he has done for you, what he has given for you, and then praise him, for his goodness endures forever. Take, eat, and drink. You may be seated. chapter 26, verses 29 and 30 go on to say, "But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. You know, it's become a tradition in our Adventist churches that when we have finished the eating and the drinking of the bread and the wine, that we sing a song. And the reason why we do so is because we too, like disciples, recognize that today we are not sad. We are happy. That God long, long ago, the Bible tells us, and Ellen G. White also says it, even before the creation of the universe, he had set in motion the plan of salvation. That is why we celebrate, because there's a solution. And today we were reminded that that solution exists. Brothers and sisters, one of the things I want to say to you today, many of you heard the one call that I sent out yesterday. I want to invite you to join me in one of the ways that we testify of what God has done for us is that we go out and we do for others what Christ has done for us. And so I found it appropriate to today, after the service, invite each and every one of you to come with me to go visit the sick and needy. There are people who don't have the privilege, like you and I, to sit in this church and to be able to take part in this act. Isn't it awesome to take to them the very thing that we get to participate in today? So I want to encourage you, please stay behind. Join me in going to visit the sick. Another custom that we have at our church is at the end, as we're singing our hymn, there will be deacons that will be standing at the door. We're going to collect an offering. We call it the love offering and benevolent offering. The money will be used to help the needy, not just in our church, but outside of our church. We want to do our part in showing God that we appreciate the sacrifice. Do not be concerned with the amount. Give what you can give. That's all that God asks. Would you like to stand with me and sing? Amen. We have this hope. Number 214, correct? Is that the one we have picked? Okay, 216, sorry. 216, we have this hope. Thank you, Lori. It is 214? Okay. All right, sorry.
Singing number 214, we have this hope. Do you have that hope now? Do you really? I want to hear you sing about it.
We have this hope that burns with we believe that.
Amen. You sounded wonderful. God bless you as you carry on in this Sabbath day.